In this video, we want to take a look at how to calculate the p-value for the Pearson correlation coefficient in Microsoft Excel using the function approach. Now, unfortunately, the p-value isn't very direct in Excel for the correlation coefficient. We have to get a little bit creative, so let me show you what I mean here. First, let's go ahead and type p-value in this cell, and then we'll work in here to get our p-value. Now, the formula for the p-value is as follows. We have equals 1 minus f distribution, where f distribution is a function. And then we have all of this information here. Now in this formula, I've underlined to make it a little bit more palatable those values which we are going to input. We're going to input these values, or in other words, these are the values that are going to change from one problem to another when calculating the p-value. All of these other things, 1 minus f distribution, squared, 1, true, and 1, those will always stay the same. So in our example here, we had a correlation of 0.86 with 13 people, or 13 sets of scores. Let's go ahead and take a look at that to make sure. So here in Excel, notice that our correlation is 0.86 if we round to two decimal places. And we do in fact have 13 people. Each person provided a number of hours studied for the exam, and they had an exam score. So our n here is equal to 13. So going back to our formula, what we can do is if we plug in r here of 0.86 right here and right here, and then we plug in, I have n minus 2 and n minus 2. So instead of 13, since n minus 2 is 11, we can plug in 11 right here and right here. Let's take a look and see what that would look like. Okay, that's what we would have here. Notice 0.86 for r, 0.86 for r once again, and then 11 for the n minus 2. And then the rest of the values, as I had said before, just stay the same. They're constants. They're always the same. Now in Excel, this value here indicates a squared value, so raised to the power of. So here we have 0.86 raised to the second power, or in other words, just square it. This is 0.86 squared. What I'll do is I'll go ahead and copy this here and enter it into Excel. And I'll enter it right here. Okay, and you can see it up here in the formula bar. When I enter that value, I get a p-value of 0.00016284. And if you saw the video on obtaining the p-value using the Data Analysis ToolPak for these same data here, you would see that this p-value is equal to the p-value that we found using the regression approach within rounding error. Okay, so in summary, we have a p-value of 0.0001 or 0.0002 if we round. And now what we want to do is test this for significance. So if we use an alpha of 0.05, we want to ask ourselves, is this p-value, is it less than 0.05? And we can see that a p-value of 0.00016 is definitely less than 0.05. So that indicates that this correlation is statistically significant, meaning that the 0.86 is significant, which indicates that there's a significant positive relationship between the number of hours studied on the exam and the exam grade. So before we close here, let's go ahead and take a look at our written results. And the written results are as follows. There's a significant positive relationship between the number of hours spent studying and the grade on the exam. And then we have R, and that stands for the Pearson R correlation, with 11 in parentheses. That stands for the degrees of freedom, which I'll show you in just a moment. This is our correlation coefficient that we saw earlier. And then we have P is less than 0.01. Okay, now a few things here. Our DF, first of all, is equal to N minus 2. And if we went back to our example, we would see that there were 13 people in that example. So the DF is equal to 13 minus 2, or 11. And that's why there's an 11 here in parentheses. The degrees of freedom go here. And then for the p of less than 0.001, since we did test at an alpha of 0.05, it would be acceptable to go ahead and write, instead of p is less than 0.001, to write p is less than 0.05 if we wanted to. However, this provides us a bit more information. Since our p-value was in fact 0.0001 or 0.0002, it is in fact less than 0.001. So we could say our p-value, this p-value here, is less than, or p is less than 0.001. And that's why I put that in the written results. Now, once again, you could put p is less than 0.05 if you wanted to. But this value gives the reader a bit more information. It lets them know how significant the results were. And usually we don't go any further than p is less than 0.001. For example, I don't see something like that very often. Usually it goes to about 1/1000th of a place or so, and that's where it stops. So if this gets smaller and smaller, we'll usually just stop at p is less than 0.001. This concludes the video on finding the p-value using the function approach in Microsoft Excel. Thanks for watching.